As a Christian, I believe that we are all created in the image of God. I believe that God loves the whole world. The life of no human being is cheap in the eyes of God, nor can it be in our own eyes. That's why we are doing this great hope seminar, because we love people to know about Jesus Christ. And if you are an Adventist, or if you are non-Christian, I would like to share to you some points that you are to find, that you need to discover when you are looking for a church. Number one is, it's about revelation. It's about the whole Bible. A lot of Christians do not believe now in the whole Bible. As I've said, the Jew I was talking with yesterday said it's just the Old Testament. And some people, some Christians would say it's the New Testament. We are now living in the New Testament. The Old Testament is past. That's only for all Israel. So you've got to find revelation. And when I speak about revelation, it's all about the teachings from Genesis to Revelation that God has revealed. Don't worry about the things that God did not reveal, because Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the things that are revealed are for us, the things that are not revealed is God. And you've got to know also, if that church, if that Christian church would teach about creation, if it's evolution, you've got to have a big question mark. Why? Because creation tells us the nature of God and the nature of man. And you've got also to see whether that church, the Christian church, teaches about redemption, salvation in Jesus Christ, salvation by grace through faith. Remember that. It's not only salvation by grace, it's salvation by grace through faith. Because salvation by grace is just half truth. But if you would like the whole truth, it must be through faith. And you've got also to see whether the church is proclaiming the whole gospel, the full gospel in the whole world. We have heard Elder Green telling us this morning that the only nations that our message have not reached are the ones that are illegalizing Christianity. But thank God that we got satellite, we got radio, and these nations, even though they are close to Christianity, they are close to Christian mission, they cannot close satellite, they cannot close the airwaves that God is using in radio, in TV. And so when they flip on their TV channels, they can reach and they can listen to God's word. The missionaries are not there, but through the TV, through the radio and all that, airwaves, they can learn about Jesus Christ. So think of that if you are looking for a Christian church. And the reason why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian is what I would like to say to you. It's because of that too. Redemption, proclamation, revelation, and about creation. World's forecast. Many have misunderstood religion as something money-oriented. And as such, they are avoiding any church membership to any Christian religion. People does not want to do anything about religion, and so they become unchurched. As I've said, they are the biggest church members. The unchurched. Because of this worldview, many does not even care to listen to any preaching of God's word due to these biases and prejudices. These biases and prejudices are the concern of Adventism. It's the concern of me as a pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Because many people misunderstood also the Seventh-day Adventist as a cult. They misjudge us without even studying what the church believes. Practically, what all people say about the church is just hearsay. Hearsay. Misinformed judgment, misunderstanding, wrong assumption, twisted information, and just plain ignorance. People are just close-minded because they do not study with an open mind what they call the church weird teachings. They are prejudiced and biased because the church belongs to a minority group of weird Christians, as the critics claim the church is. Weird as it is before people's eyes, if only people will examine what the Adventist Church believes, they will discover that the Word of God is the basis of their faith practice. Amen. Amen. The Bible is clear that the end church is a Bible-believing, Bible-obeying church that keeps the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. That's in Revelation 14:12. Yet is the patience of the saints here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. If people would only learn and study about the teachings and beliefs of churches, they can come to a biblical conclusion that such particular church, like the Seventh-day Adventist Christian Church, must be the church of the living God, because its teachings are based from the Bible. After careful study, and you have proven it to be Bible-based church, I'm speaking to members and non-members, Because you have all the right to study and to check and to examine what we believe as a church. Then join the church, because if Christ would be here on earth, he will also be joining the church. Why? Because it's a church that bases teachings of the Bible. And I believe if Christ would be here, he would join the church whose teachings and whose belief practices and belief systems are solely based from the Old and the New Testament. Now I would like to share to you why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. But first of all, let me share to you the not because reasons why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian not because of its worldwide work. Because I can join the Rotary Club. I can join the Lions Club. They are worldwide. In fact, when I was in the Philippines, the mayor of the town of Camiling was telling me, I can sponsor you to be a part of the Rotary Club here in Western Tarlac, because you can have the privilege to go to America when we have this international meeting. And then he told me all of these Jews and all of this, was this money spending? And I said, I'm not at risk to spend that much. Because if we got a party, he said, say for example, we got a party, and they choose you to be the one in charge of everything, then that's your day, that's your night. That will be my night, that will be the case, because I don't have the money to pay. And so I said, thank you for your invitation, Mayor. I said, but I cannot do it financially. He was thinking that pastors and the Seventh Day Adventist Church are rich, like the other churches. So I'm not a Seventh Day Adventist Christian because of the worldwide work of the Seventh Day Adventist Church. No, because there's a lot of worldwide work also, organization. The second reason, I am a Seventh Day Adventist Christian not because the church is perfect. It's because of you. It's because of me. Amen?
Amen.
But there is hope.
Great hope.
Yes, great hope.
Amen.
Amen. Number three, not because of money making. Pastor's salary is just enough to provide for my family. Praise the Lord. And thank God for your gifts. I look good also with this. I don't know who gave this because of the last of gifts that I receive. I don't know if it's from the deaconesses, from the young adults, or from the church. I don't know. But it's good. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. The church is funded with money coming from membership worldwide and is being used religiously for the gospel work. It supports also the educational system, publishing, humanitarian work, and health system operated worldwide by the church, etc., etc. Amen. Now I would like to share to you why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. Because of Jesus' words. As I've said, this is a continuation of what we have started last night. Jesus' words is, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Way means his way of doing things. Amen. He says, I came not to do my own will, but I am to do of my Father's will. Clearly, his way is doing his Father's will. That's unquestionable. Truth means the Bible truth. Not what I say, not what you say. Because sometimes, as I've said last night, it's relative truth. And that's not acceptable in the eyes of God. God is a God of truth, and he will never lie and will not lie and could not tell a lie. God sanctifies us with his word. John 17:17, sanctify them through your word. Thy word is truth. Amen.
Amen.
Heart knowledge, though, is very important. Not only the head knowledge, but a heart knowledge. Because if I know the information that I need to know from the Bible, but I don't know the author and I don't have a relationship with the author of that book, of that Bible, then it's worthless. My knowledge, my head knowledge is worthless. It must be heart knowledge that goes with the head knowledge. Amen?
Amen.
Number one, life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He didn't say, I am a way, I am a truth, I am a life. No, he says, the. It's a very definite article in the English grammar. He didn't say, I am like a way. It seems like I am truth. He didn't say that. It's very specific, very definite. I am the way. How do you pronounce grammarian? The way, the truth, and the life. Life means it's not only the source and sustainer of life, but the kind of life he showed as an example of loving sacrificial service to all. And we see it demonstrated where? At the cross. It's a selfless sacrificial love that was shown at the cross. And that's what we need to have as a Christian. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Life, it also speaks of the plan of redemption in saving us, speaks of the kind of life, sacrificial love. He has redeemed us from sins that we can have life everlasting. That's very, very important to us who believe in him. If the way shows me how to live and where I am going, the truth tells me who to know and what to believe.
Yeah.
Then life demands me how to die to self, so that I could live the more abundant life that Sister Ruby was emphasizing in her lecture. Because he said, I have come that they may have life more abundantly. He didn't only say that they may have life, and that's it. No, he said that they may have life and have it more abundantly. Very expressive. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, there is hope.
Great hope.
Yes, great hope.
Amen.
Amen. Therefore, the way, the truth, and the life is wrapped up in this one time God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, since this is the only true God. Amen. Believe in God and you will have life everlasting in Jesus Christ. Jesus' own words also says, I have other sheep that are not of this fold. He got sheep. In the Roman Catholic Church, in the Methodist Church, in the Pentecostal Church, in the Presbyterian Church,
in the
Mormon Church, he got all of them there, scattered in the supposedly Christian denominations in the whole world. But he says, "I have other sheep that are not in this fold. Them will I call," he says, "and they will come and join, and there'll be one fold and one shepherd." This means that the followers of Christ, which are sheep here in this text, are in the different religious organization worldwide. But he is calling them to join his fold, his own religion. And when he calls, his sheep knows his voice and they follow him. And that's why when I pray for an interest, I would say, Lord, I believe that's your sheep.
Yeah.
I don't know, but you know, I said. Please, call him, call her, because when he is or she is your sheep, it says there, they will hear your voice. He or she will hear your voice. This means that the gospel commission, the medium by which men and women, boys and girls, are being called to follow Jesus Christ. And here now is what we are doing. We are calling men and women, boys and girls, everybody, to a love relationship with Jesus Christ. I am a servant that is Christian because Jesus' own words, when he said in the book of Revelation through the pen of John the Revelator 14:12, it says, here are the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God. And watch this. And have the faith. He didn't say faith in Jesus. Because I may have the faith in Jesus, but it's possible that I may not have the faith of Jesus. But if I have the faith of Jesus, then it follows that I will have also the faith in Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
That's the fold. We must be a member of his faith, his religion. The faith of Jesus is associated with the keeping of God's commandments. That's why I'm a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, because I believe that what I am preaching and teaching, what we believe, is in accordance with the faith of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Therefore, I'm a Seventh Adventist because of Jesus Christ, my Savior and Lord, who has called me to join his fold and to practice his faith as the sheep, one of the sheep of his pasture. Number two, I'm a Seventh Adventist Christian because of biblical truth. Not what people say, not what my pastor or your pastor say or your rabbi says, or your priest says, it's what the Bible says. Amen.
Amen.
And that's what we call absolute truth. People would say there are no longer absolute truths. You follow what you feel, right? You follow what you feel good, and you'll be all right. But that's not really biblical truth. In 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, in righteousness. It's not only instruction whatsoever, but it says specifically in righteousness. That the man of God may be complete and thoroughly equipped on every good work. And what's this? Doctrines keeps you, teaches you right. Amen?
Yeah.
Reproof keeps you right. Correction shapes you right. And instruction guides you right. Amen. And thank God. Thank God. 3 John 3:3-4, it says, for I rejoice greatly. John the Revelator was saying, John the Beloved, because John the Beloved is John the Revelator, and John the Revelator and John the Beloved is one of the inner circle, right? Peter, James, and John. For I rejoice greatly when brethren came, speaking of you now, and testified to the truth that is in you. Just as you walk in the truth, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. I just came from Pomana convention, and when I was preaching there, I said, a lot of people would say to a pastor or the preacher, that sermon is powerful, good, the best preaching that I have heard. But you know, I said, as a pastor, the best preaching that a pastor could do is when people are being impacted. When people are being changed, I said, when people are being transformed, regardless of what you would say, if I don't see a change in the life of people, that's not a powerful preaching, I said. It may be a powerful preaching though, but it's because of me, we're so close-minded, right? But what I am saying here is, the greatest joy for a pastor is when he preaches and he sees the difference that has impacted in the lives of the members. Amen. And that's what John was saying. Number three. I am a Seventh Adventist Christian because of prophetic interpretation. And thank God, God is not overtaken by any surprise, neither that he is caught in an emergency, because he already have an answer to everything of your questions. Any question that is related to salvation, any question that is related to spiritual things that is really very necessary and needful in your relationship with Jesus Christ, is already there in the Bible. And that's why he says, and so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to hear as a light. Amen. Bible truth is like a light. Psalms 105, 119, 105, he says, thy word is a light unto my path and a lamp unto my feet. Did I mix it together, all together? But that's what he's saying. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I think that's the right one. That shines in a dark place until the dawns and the morning star rises in your eye. Who is the morning star?
Jesus Christ.
It's Jesus Christ. Amen. From Genesis to Revelation, the theme of the Bible is Jesus and how he came to save men. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, there is hope. Yes, great hope.
For
you and for me. Amen. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of men. But only men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. I could not try to manipulate the interpretation of what the Bible says. I could not explain it in another way. Because if I will be explaining it in another way to conform to my favor, conform to my likings, then it is of private interpretation. Let the Bible explain for itself, because the Bible is its own expositor. You know, these are principles of hermeneutics that is not original among Seventh-day Adventists. It came from the Protestant Reformation. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, as a Seventh-day Adventist, we got a very distinct, unique interpretation of prophecy. And there are three major, there may be more, but there are three major interpretations of prophecy. Prophecy is one of the hardest biblical passages to interpret and to explain and to understand by Bible students, scholars, and theologians. Number one is preterism. It applies only during the time of the prophets. That's what we call them, preterists. Historicism, it applies during the prophet's time, but it spans throughout the Christian era until Christ's coming. It means it applies to you. That's why we call them historicists. Futurism, it applies in the future. So, don't worry about apocalyptic literature still, because it's still in the future. But thank God, as a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, we believe that we have to follow and interpret and explain prophecy in the historical method of interpretation. And I'm so happy that we as a church believe on that. Why? Because if that be the case, it's preterism, then it's not for me because it's Bible prophecy already passed. If it's future, it's not for me because it's still in the future. But thank God it applies for you and for me in this current modern age, in this age of skepticism, in this age of ignorance of the Bible, in this age of people not believing, even scoffing and reading the Bible, ridiculing the Bible. This is the time that we need to understand what prophecy is all about. Amen. I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian because of the health message. Thank God we got our health leader here so conscious about the health message. You know, I have observed in the house, and this is a new thing for you probably also, that Mervyn have a change, a dramatic change in lifestyle.
Amen.
He's now trying to imbibe the health message of the Seventh-day Adventist Christian Church. Before, he doesn't want any fruit. Banana. But now, he would buy his own, and he even would cook even his own, and he would criticize our cooking with his mom because his cooking is more healthy than what we are cooking.
Amen.
Yeah. Before, I was cooking, preparing both of the meal, my wife and him, but now, he does his own because he said, I don't like your cooking. It's too much salt. It's not healthy. Health message. I am so happy that I belong to a church that is health oriented. But as I have said so many times, it's a slap on our face as Seventh-day Adventist members because the world is even now ahead of us. They are headway to our health message. But we, sometimes we question, sometimes we ridicule in all of this. But I'm a Seventh-day Adventist Christian because of our health message. Amen?
Amen.
Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. Just as your soul, Sister Ruby was saying, there are five aspects of our health. And it's really true. And I will add to what Mervyn's lifestyle has changed. Even his devotional reading has changed.
Amen.
If he got no time, if he's rushing to work and all that, he will be reading his devotional right on the table while he was having breakfast.
Amen.
Take a spoonful, then read. Or read first and then eat. But before, I don't know, he was reading his Bible or what. That's a change. Why? Because it says here, just as your soul prospers. It's not only about physical health. It's not only about emotional health. It's not only about social health. It's not only about mental health. But it's about also spiritual health. And that's what he calls now holistic. It's letter H, not letter W. Holistic approach on health. Because if you got the holistic approach on health, which is H, you will have also the holistic, which is W. Method or lifestyle of health. Amen?
Amen.
I am so thankful that we as a church got all of these messages, got all of these principles on health. Are you happy that you are a Seventh-day Adventist Christian?
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Or you are still questioning why you are a Seventh-day Adventist Christian? Number five reason. I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian because of Christian living. You know, I'm so surprised. In California, you know, California, we got all the Filipino membership there, a lot of Filipino membership in California. We got the conservative and the liberal, I don't know which is conservative, Southern California, Northern California, or Central California. But what I observed when I was there, I haven't seen any Seventh-day Adventists. And I mentioned that in my sermon, because it has now plagued the church also, when it comes to Christian adornment. And I was observing. And I said, I might have this audience of historic Seventh-day Adventists. Because there are what we call now the historic Seventh-day Adventists. They are the original that have all of this understanding about what Christian life is all about. And I believe that God has given us the right principles when it comes to Christian living. It's not only about Christian adornment. It's about also about Christian deportment. That's why I'm so happy that we were converted to the Seventh-day Adventist message, Because it has changed not only our lifestyle, but it has also changed where our direction is. Amen? Amen. Because God doesn't see us where we are, which is our condition, sinful condition. We are shaping in iniquity, forming the womb in sin. Came out in my mother's womb in sin, because I am a sinner by birth and a sinner by choice. So I'm a sinner in two hands. But praise the Lord, we got hope.
Great hope.
Yes, great hope.
For you,
because Christ can change us. Amen.
Amen.
Into a Christian, a real, genuine Christian. I am a Seventh Adventist Christian because it is here where I have learned how to live really the Christian life. You know, when I was a student, I got a roommate, as I've shared many times with you, an atheist. Even though he doesn't call himself an atheist, he just say, I'm an agnostic. And he would always convince me not to be a Seventh Adventist pastor someday. But in all of my classes that I have attended, especially when I was taking all of my major subjects now, I would not be silent in class. I would try to argue whether this is really right, this is really true, because I'm picturing myself that someday I'll be a pastor and I'll be teaching falsehood, then I transgress the commandment, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. So I said to myself, let me really examine it for my own sake. If whether the Seventh Adventist really is right, because this roommate would always tell me, how would you know that the Seventh Adventist teachings is really right and true? Because if you would finish as a pastor and you would be teaching falsehood, then you yourself will also land in hellfire. And so that was so serious to me. That was a serious matter to me. But thank God, I'm a Seventh Adventist Christian, because I know that the Bible has set forth Christian principles and virtues that we need to show and to follow. That's why the Gospel Commission to me is just summarized in three words. Show, go, and tell. Because I'm not only to go, I must have to show. And I'm not only to go and show, but I must have to tell. That's why we are telling. We have this Great Hope Seminar, because we would like to tell, amen? But it's not only telling, it's not only going, but it's also showing, which is the most important thing. Showing. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you in the revelation of Jesus Christ as obedient children. Amen. Not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. We serve a holy God. That's why we need also to live a holy life. Because it would be a humiliation of the cross of Jesus Christ if I'm not living up to that standard. We may not be perfect, because no one is perfect. But as I've said, God sees us in our direction. Remember David, he was called a man according to God's own heart. Huh? According to God's own heart, he killed Uriah. According to God's own heart, he committed adultery. But if God looks not in his condition, he was looking in his direction.
Amen.
And that's why,
amen.
We got hope! Great hope! Amen, amen. I am a Seventh Adventist Christian because of the Gospel Commission. I would like to participate in this preaching of the Word of God. I love preaching. I love evangelism. If you would go to my former church, the Word of Faith Church, and if they have a question among the church members during church anniversary, what would be the statement that will stand in your mind that comes from Pastor Baiza? They would say, evangelism, evangelism, soul winning. Let's go preach. Let's go tell people about Jesus. Let's go give Bible studies. And because that's what I was telling them. Because I love to share this old story. Amen. It gives me that joy when I see people. Just look around. We see people here that has been a product of our preaching of the Word of God. We got the family, Sister Rosie and her family. We got the Gracia family. We got Colin. They said that they're coming tonight, but I don't know what happened. You see, If we can really see the power of the gospel in the lives of people, and we can see them change, it gives you the joy. That's why soul winning is character development. God is not only telling us, share me in my joy. Because in heaven, only one sinner, it says there, the angels would have a party in Luke 15. And I'm so thankful that I belong to a church, to a Seventh-day Adventist church that proclaims the gospel message into all the world. That's why we are called Catholic Christians. Not Roman Catholic Christians, but we are Catholic Christians. Why? Because we are worldwide, we are universal. And Catholic means universal. And Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them. So in our going, we've got to teach people, he says, observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. All of this, my friends, will be taught to us as we come. It will be rehearsed to us. We, members of the church, this is like a rehearsal course for you. This evangelism that we are doing, this great hope forecast, hope prophecy forecast seminar, is just a review for all of us here, many of us here. And to those that are new, it gives you that kind of understanding why you must be a member of Christ's fold, a commandment-keeping church. Amen?
Amen.
The promise is, I am with you even to the end of the age. Remember I told last night, I'm surprised and still a wonder for me. We got one God, one Bible, but we have different religious organizations around. But if only people would study the Bible and follow the Bible and interpret the Bible, what it means and what it says, there would only be one, I believe. There would only be one. And come every night and you will learn why I say there would only be one. There would only be one. Because it says here, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. Have you ever realized that the preaching of the Word of God, when people are changed, that it says here that they will also, they really don't believe on you now. They're not taking your word. They are really believing on God. Amen?
Amen.
That's why sometimes we say, oh, he's cerrado, candado, católico. Just tell. Yeah, it's not only cerrado, but it's also candado. Yeah, it's not only closed, it's also locked. But give them the opportunity to know why, because it's not us, it's not me, it's not you to convert. It's the power now of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, I have a lot of experience like that. They don't believe, but as long as they would like to listen and to hear, the Holy Spirit will change them. And I got many to share to you tonight, but we don't have time. I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. Let's review. Because of Jesus' own words, because of biblical truth, because of prophetic interpretation that is unique in Adventism, which is historicism, health message, the Christian living that we know, and we need to apply it. It's not only information, but it's transformation. Amen?
Amen.
And gospel commission. And the last, put it seven last night, I put it also seven today. It's because of God's love. It's because of God's love. I'm a Seventh Adventist Christian because of God's love. Why? Because in 1 John 3:4 it says, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. What is lawlessness? It's without law, right? Yeah, lawlessness, sleepless nights, you didn't have a sleep. So lawlessness is without law. Have you imagined a government without law? It will be chaos, right? Even in your own family life, there are laws in your family life, in your own family, in your own home. Because law is so important to guide people and to live, and that, so that they can live in a peaceful, orderly life. And God, who is the God of peace and order, has a law. Amen. But people, and you will learn more as we come here every night, why people are antinomianists. Antinomianism is so. You know, the reason why the street, the traffic lights, are illegal now? Because they put it in the referendum, in the election. People doesn't want prohibitions. They wanted freedom. They didn't know that law, when they are abiding law citizens, they got freedom. And that's why when they put it into the ballots, people doesn't want those street lights, so they voted no. That's why I was telling my wife, yeah, they should not have put it in the ballots. Because who would like to say, who would like to be said, don't do this, don't do that? That's our nature. Wet paint, don't touch. What do we do? We touch. We try it. And that's why, you know, sometimes it's funny why people doesn't want to be within the law, especially the Ten Commandments, when it gives them that peace and that order in the land. That you may charge some that teach no other doctrine, nor give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which cause disputes rather than godly edification, which is in faith. Remember that, in faith. Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart. It's very specific here. From a good conscience and from sincere faith. Once again, faith. From which some, having strayed, have turned aside to idle talk, desiring to be teachers. Wow. Desiring to be teachers of the law. And watch this. Understanding neither what they say nor the things which they affirm. Try to talk with people. They contradict. It's what their statements, they go in contradiction. They could not harmonize. And I would say, which really do you believe? This one or the one that you said a while ago? Because it goes contrary with each other now. Why? Because the Bible is plain when it says, they don't understand neither what they say nor the things which they affirm. But we know that the law is good. Amen?
Amen.
In Romans 7:12, it says there that the law is good, holy, just, and good. Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous person. Remember that. I'm not a righteous person, neither you are. Amen? But for the lawless and insubordinate, for the ungodly and for sinners, for the unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for fornicators, wow, for sodomites, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjurers. And if there is any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. So it means then that the law could not be laid aside, right? Because we are all there. So we need the law to direct us and to guide us. I could not say I'm no longer under the binding claims of the law of God. Why? Because the more that I need now because of my fallen state, or because of my fallen nature. According to the glorious gospel, remember this, the law of God is in accordance with the gospel. Sometimes people would say, the law of God is against the gospel, or the gospel is against the law. No. It says here, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust, Paul was saying to Timothy. Therefore, I am a Seventh Adventist Christian, because the church upholds God's law. Amen. And it's not only 9 commandments, it's complete 10 commandments. Love. Some people would say, well, if you have love, that's enough. Come every night and we will tell you, and we will try to explain and to answer those arguments. Because it's really true that the Bible says love is the fulfilling of the law. But it doesn't say love is the ending of the law. Didn't say that. Love is the fulfilling. So if I got love, then I am to fulfill. Why? Because love is the fulfilling of the law. That's in Romans 13:8-10. And so we see here that the Seventh Adventist Christian Church upholds and teaches and even practices what God's law is all about. Because it's subdivided into love to God and love to man. And that's why Christ said, when he was here on earth, he says, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold. This fold that keeps the commandments of God. This fold that obeys the 10 commandments. This fold that is obeying fold. He says, there are other sheep I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring. He used the word must bring. And they will hear my voice. Amen. So if you are here tonight, And you are having some questions regarding the law of God. You are having some questions regarding whether it is really true, it's really not, or what. God says, I have sheep that are not in this fold, in this Bible-obeying Christian church. I will bring them, I must bring them, he says, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock. That's one reason I say there must only be one religion in the whole world. Because it says there is one flock. I don't care what name is that religion, but the oneness of that religion is they are all commandment-keeping church. Amen. And one shepherd. I need to give you, as we wrap up today, a hope prophecy forecast. Before we end, before the close of probation, and I'm speaking to all of us now, whether you be a church member or a non-church member, or you are still debating whether you be a Christian or join a church or what, it says here, before the close of probation, God is calling men and women, boys and girls, to a faith and love relationship with Him through Christ, His only Son. This faith, what's this, is evidenced by its works of obedience, called as the obedience of the faith. Oh, there is an obedience of the faith. So I'm not only believing as a mental assent to truth, but it says there, I must have to practice what I believe. I must have to show what I believe. I must have to do what I believe, because it says here, there is the obedience of faith. Your attendance will give you enough knowledge to know Jesus Christ and His teachings as His spouse and His evident in His church. We have great hope. Yes, great hope. Amen. Great hope for a better world in the new heavens and in the new earth as promised by God in the Bible. For your information, the Seventh Adventist Church worldwide is a Bible-believing and Bible-obeying Christian church that believes in Jesus Christ as the Redeemer of men and women, boys and girls who accept Him as Lord and Savior, as well as accepting Him as the head of the church. I'm not saying this because I am a Seventh Adventist pastor, but I am saying this out of love and out of my discovery of Bible truth, that I could not find any other religious organization that matches what the Bible says when it comes to commandment keeping in the last days. By God's grace, the Seventh Adventist Church is one of the fastest growing Protestant churches in North America. And around the world, with its current membership of 18 million, approximately 18 million membership worldwide. Yes, the Spirit says, come, and the Christ says, come. That's an invitation for all of us. In these last days, many will join Christ's body, the Church of the Living God, the pillar and ground of truth. Come May, the worldwide president of our church, Elder Wilson, will go to the Philippines to proclaim the gospel message there. And he's inviting many pastors to join him in that preaching. And I sign up myself with the rest of the Filipinos here in the Union from the Texaco Conference. I haven't yet spoken with Pastor Rodrigo, if he's joining us, that we'll be going there. That's why I spoke today with Pastor Mangilima. Because it's the request I sent to the Texaco Conference pastors, that give us a good territory that will encourage us when we come and proclaim the gospel message. It's an opportunity for Metro Manila to hear, even not only Metro Manila, because it will be telecast. And it's Elder Wilson, the worldwide president of the Seventh Adventist Church, who will be the evangelist, will just be the one who will support and make the ground preparation for the tripping campaign sometime May. Yes, my friends, in these last days, many will join Christ's body. And this body is the Church of the Living God, the pillar and ground of truth. I am a Seventh Adventist Christian. You are a Seventh Adventist Christian. And you will be a Seventh Adventist Christian. I am a Seventh Adventist Christian because I believe with all my heart that the Church demonstrates the Church of the Living God, that keeps the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Yes, my friend, there is hope, great hope for you and me today. Just follow the good and loving shepherd Jesus Christ as an obedient sheep of His hope, His church, the church of the living God.
Amen.
What is your answer tonight? Would you say, Lord, I would like to join your fold? And if you are a member now, would you like to recommit yourself to be faithful until the end? Because he says that there will be one fold and one shepherd. I would like to be under the shepherdship of Jesus Christ, the bishop of my soul, the shepherd of my soul. Who among you here tonight would like to recommit their lives and say, Lord, I would like to follow you because you are the good and the loving shepherd. And help me, those that are not yet a member of his fold. Your prayer is, help me that I can join your fold so that there will be one fold. And I'm in that fold. And I'll be your sheep and you'll be my shepherd.
Amen.
Would you like to stand with me tonight and say, Lord, I'm recommitting myself to be a part of your fold. And I am trying, if you are not yet a part of the fold, I am trying by your grace and by the power that you will give to me and by the wisdom and the understanding that you will give to me, that I will also join your fold. I don't care what the name of that fold is, but thank God, providentially, it's called the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the book of Revelation chapter 10. The prophetic interpretation of Revelation 10 is a fulfillment. When the great disappointment came, it was not really a great disappointment, but it was a great appointment for God's people. They had discovered wonderful truths that Protestants and Catholics are not teaching and are not practicing even today. Sometimes they even ridicule. You have heard Elder Green. They would think strange when you say you are a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. But he forgot to quote to you that in that chapter also, Ellen White says that the name Seventh-day Adventist, is a standing rebuke, she says, to the Protestant world. Why? Because the Protestant says the Bible and the Bible only. Sola Scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia. But then he said, thank God he raised the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the book of Revelation chapter 10. That's why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, because I belong to a prophetic movement that was in the book of Revelation after the religious awakening in the 1800s. We were organized 1860. Our name was registered Seventh-day Adventist in the year 1863. And until now, the preaching of God's word is being proclaimed by our church. And so I am happy and I am fortunate that I belong to this church that keeps the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Do you?
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, tonight you have given us this wonderful, wonderful calling, an invitation from the Spirit who says, come. And the bride, we the church, would also give out that invitation to people. Come. That's the reason why we have this great hope prophecy forecast seminar. Because we would like to invite our friends, our own family members also, that are not in this fold of Bible-believing, Bible-obeying Christian church. Because someday soon, Jesus, our great hope, is coming. And when he comes, may all of us that stood today, that have recommitted our faith and love relationship with you, to just stay in the fold. And for those that have stood up also to say, Lord, I would like to join this fold. Help me that in my studies, in my own personal examination of Bible truth, I can not only find the truth, but I can find Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. And if that's your prayer tonight, God is here to make it happen because he loves you so much that he gave his only begotten son to die on the cross, endure the pain, endure the torture, endure the suffering, so that you can have life more abundantly on this earth, but life immortal and life everlasting when he comes. Be with us, O Lord, as we have recommitted ourselves, and give us that power to live a real life of a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, that the world may know that we are your disciples. For I pray, the blessed name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, and all God's people say, Amen.
Amen.